Musk speaks. Booster 14.1 is undergoing catch testing. Will they drop it? SpaceX is working hard to prepare for Flight 5. Musk drops a huge update and explains why the boosters on previous flights kept failing. Europe's new Ariane 6 is finally ready. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. It has been a week full of updates and progress from paperwork to new testing. Flight 5 feels like it is right around the corner, with Flight 6 not far behind, and there is a big secret about Flight 7. Want to learn more? Let's do this, follow me. Starbase was just hit by a tropical storm, but SpaceX just pulled through. In fact, during parts of the storm, we could even see workers continuing to work around Starbase. Let's take a look at what exactly happened. This time we are going to start our journey to the future at the build site, where we spotted SpaceX moving some hooks for the Star Factory. These hooks are used with gantry cranes inside the Star Factory to move large components around. I am sure the workers will appreciate not having to lift these pieces by hand. We were able to spot the actual gantry cranes being moved in a few weeks ago, and seeing these hooks is an excellent sign of SpaceX's progress inside the factory. But the Star Factory isn't the only thing that has seen some amazing progress. Moving over just a bit, we have Ship 30, which has received a massive heat shield overhaul over the last few weeks. Last week we mentioned teams had begun adding the ablative underlayer and the new Starbreak 2 tiles. Thanks to our photographer John, we can see the enormous amount of progress made. Take a look at the aft flaps. They've now received the new ablative layer. The goal of this layer is to prevent damage to the primary structure or hull. If a tile is lost in these places, the ablative layer will start carbonizing as soon as the plasma heat hits it. The material will then start to burn away, which takes the heat with it. Ablative shielding in a nutshell, non-reusable but very effective as a last line of defense. Workers still haven't worked on the more unique areas, such as the curved flap joints. During Flight 4, it is likely that the joints were the components that failed, so we will keep an eye out if they begin work on those areas. Unfortunately, we can't keep an eye on Booster 12, which is being worked on in one of the mega bays. This bay has had its door closed for a while now, but Booster 12 basically does have a prototype undergoing tests on its behalf. A few episodes ago, we covered a brand new test tank at Starbase, Booster number 14.1. At that time, it was still at Massey's after its time in the so-called Can Crusher test stand. This was to verify the strengths of the mini booster's lifting and catch pins. These pins are used by the chopsticks to hoist the super heavy booster onto the pad. This booster, however, has lifting pins so that SpaceX can test the load forces they will face during a real super heavy catch attempt. It basically is a catch test can. Remember this, it will become important later. Recently, on the 21st of June, the tank was rolled away from Massey's to go to... Wait, what is that in the road closure document? The launch site? That has to be a mistake, right? Nope. In fact, just a few hours after its departure, Booster 14.1 arrived at the launch site before being lifted onto the OLM by the GMK 7550 crane.
Look, there is a baby booster in the nest.
Don't worry, there is a perfectly reasonable explanation for this. The tank is likely here for even more Flight 5 catch testing. It'll act as a sort of proxy for Booster 12. There are two possible things that SpaceX might plan to accomplish with this booster, and both would be a catch simulation. The first and less dangerous profile would be a simulation of catch procedures from touchdown. Basically, Booster 14.1 would be hoisted by the chopsticks to the same height a normal booster would hit the chopsticks at. It would then undergo any pre-landing maneuvers. This might include moving the booster forward or backward. They would then set it back down on its transport stand and the test would be over. Not too complicated. Or dangerous. Now for the fun one. The most fun part about this one is that it is the most likely scenario. The idea would be to drop test the tank. Yep, that is right. SpaceX might attempt to drop a giant stainless steel can on the chopsticks. It would most likely go somewhat like this. The chopsticks would begin in a stationary position, arms open wide enough for a catch. Then SpaceX's giant LR11000 crane would lift the Booster 14.1 test tank into the air above the arms.
The baby booster would learn to fly.
The crane would likely only hold the prototype a couple of inches above the catch arms before releasing the tank and letting the landing rails on the arms slow its fall. The catch would then be dampened by those rails, which raise and lower to shave off the booster's velocity. This would validate a couple of very important things. First, it would prove that the current Super Heavy design is capable of sustaining the forces of a drop. What if the engines cut off too early? This would test that. Secondly, it would show how likely Super Heavy is to make it if not everything goes perfectly. And lastly, it would give SpaceX real-time data of a catch before actually having to commit to it on the upcoming Flight 5. I personally hope this is the case, as it will give them experience in catch procedures and insight into the chopstick's capabilities. Albeit a little more risky than the other option, this would certainly be much closer to actual flight data. But before we talk about that, we've looked into our channel metrics and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not yet subscribed. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a WISE supporter for exclusive SpaceX updates. With it, you get access to daily Starbase photo galleries, including satellite, aerial, and ground photos of SpaceX's progress and countless other extras on top. And no matter how much you decide to give, everyone gets the same supporter content and access. You decide what you want to give. So I said that the dangerous drop is more likely than the other less dangerous test, didn't I? Here's the reason. We've already seen a closure that could be for this test. On Tuesday the 25th, so the day you're watching this, an 8-hour closure is scheduled for quote, non-flight testing with backups on the 26th and 27th. This could very well be for this drop test, as it includes a full closure which might not be needed for simple lifting. No official word was given as I recorded this. It is possible that by the time you are watching this video, the test is about to happen. Check our 24/7 cams. After watching this episode, you might get lucky. Whatever happens to this tank, excitement is guaranteed. Alright, let's not let Booster 14.1 take the whole spotlight. Another tank has seen some action this week, but this time it wasn't being built or tested, it was being destroyed. On the evening of the 21st, the Liebherr 11000 crane was hooked up to the third ground support equipment shell and began lifting it away. The crane held it in place next to Highway 4, and SpaceX demolition crews were seen cutting it into pieces as usual. This is the seventh shell to be scrapped, which leaves only one remaining. The peculiar thing about SpaceX's decision to scrap this particular tank is that they never scrapped GSE Tank 1 before moving on to the next tank. I say this because each GSE tank has a protective white shell on the outside used for insulation and damage protection. In the past, we saw the GSE tank scrapped right after the protective shell, but this time it seems SpaceX has moved to the next shell without scrapping the tank within. Now, this seems weird at first glance, but there may be some very good reasons that they have opted to continue this way. The first is that SpaceX no longer uses these tanks for cryogenic fluid storage, which means that getting rid of them is no longer a first priority. On past flights, it was essential that the tanks they chose to remove were gone prior to liftoff. With the launch so far out, they can take their time in removing these tanks. The second is that removing the shells first is much easier, as they are not plumbed in and they all require the same size of lifting jig. They have to switch the lifting jig to lift the internal GSE tanks, as they are smaller. This makes removing all three shells the most logical step before proceeding to removing the tanks within. And it shouldn't matter anyway, as SpaceX will have all these tanks removed before Flight 5, so there is no cause for concern about the bare GSE tanks becoming crushed cans. It's also worth noting that yet another horizontal bullet tank has been delivered to the launch site for the new tank farm. We've talked much about the decision to replace the old tank farm, and the new one has turned into a truly giant project by now. Now that we've examined Orbital Pad A, let's examine the other pad at Starbase, the one that is still under construction, Orbital Pad B. SpaceX is vastly expanding launch capabilities for a future that holds thousands more launches for Starbase. The tower has seen significant work recently, and the base is nearly complete. The protective panels on the side of the base have all been installed, and it now merely awaits the internal concrete to be poured. They do this to strengthen the very base of the tower, as it is what the entire structure sits on. After that, the first segment of the tower can then be stacked. Although we haven't seen any signs of an imminent roll of the sections, I imagine it will happen very soon. SpaceX seems quite set on getting this tower done soon, which means that the stacking of this massive structure isn't far out. The crane that will complete this task is already prepared for stacking the initial segments at this site. However, this won't be sufficient for later segments, so SpaceX is already looking into the future for faster tower construction. The longer boom that the Demag CC8801 crane will use to lift the tower pieces off the ground is practically already completed. Although it is not connected to the crane yet, once the stacking of lower sections has concluded, the boom can be swapped out for the longer one. This is necessary to stack higher sections. The CC8801 crane itself assembled the boom, showing that it is operational and ready for use. What do you think? Will the tower sections be rolled out soon? How fast will they stack the tower? And will it be completed before or after Flight 5? Leave a comment below. I love reading them. Next, we have some huge news regarding a SpaceX FCC application and a possible Block 2 Starship. It might not seem like much at first, but if you look closer and read between the lines, this document holds some huge news. For SpaceX to communicate with Starship and Super Heavy during a launch and landing, they need access to specific radio frequencies. In this case, they are seeking new frequencies because they are using new radio controllers on the ships. This means they need to file for permission from the Federal Communication Commission, or FCC, for that equipment to use those frequencies. Not to be confused with the FAA. This also means that we get to see all the information SpaceX provided to the FCC for this process, revealing some pretty interesting things about Flight 5 and even beyond. For starters, we have a somewhat official date, July 19th. Take it with two shiploads of salt, but that is less than a month away. This date is not a launch date. Instead, it is more of a no earlier than date, as this is when SpaceX is requesting the FCC license to go into effect. But that wasn't the only information in the application, as we also have a possible Starship Block 2 launch evidence. Let's take a look. The FCC application states that it will only be used for Flight 5 and 6, and that Flight 7 will be a further evolution of the RF system on the ship. So Flight 7 will fly with a different antenna design. This is an upgraded communication system similar to how Ship 31's antennas are different from previous generations, such as Ship 26's and Ship 29's. This does raise an important question. What ship will fly on Flight 7? As of now, it appears Ship 32 will be the ship flying on Flight 7. However, it hasn't seen any work in a while and has just been sitting in the rocket garden, even still missing its aft flaps. The question is if Ship 32 has the same antennas as Ship 31. That would be the definitive proof for it not flying. So SpaceX may plan to skip Ship 32 and move on to a more upgraded ship design, possibly Block 2. What do you think SpaceX's plan for Ship 32 is? Will it meet the same fate as Ship 20 and never leave the rocket garden? Or will it get an upgrade and fly on Flight 7? Let us know in the comments. This FCC application wasn't the only thing that shed light on the future of the Starship program. Musk also shared some new information in an interview. Tim Dodd had the honor again. Let's start with what was revealed about the filter blockages on Flights 2 and 3, and possibly even the cause of the quitting landing engine on Flight 4. Musk has now revealed the filter blockages were not caused by debris inside the tank, but by ice, which formed when ullage gases froze in the tank.
They got clogged by ice.
Ice in the tanks? How can this even happen? And why is this a problem for Starship and not other rockets? Well, it has to do with how the ullage gas is produced. Helium is typically used on most rockets, but Starship uses partially burned propellants to save weight on helium tanks. The gas is not clean. Musk referred to it as ox-rich gas, which tells a story. Who would have thought? This means that some water and CO2 produced by the chemical reaction inside the pre-burners get pumped into the tanks. It is a byproduct of burning methane and oxygen. At 6 bar, which is the flight pressure of a Starship, CO2 freezes at around minus 57 Celsius or minus 70 Fahrenheit, and water obviously freezes at even higher temperatures. Space is way colder. Ice blocked the ullage gas thrusters, and it might have also caused the LOX intake blocking on the boosters. Hopefully, SpaceX will find a solution to this problem soon. Another thing Musk talked about was the upcoming Raptor V3 engine. Musk stated during the interview that the V3 will look almost unfinished, with how many parts will be directly integrated into the engine. So the render SpaceX released of the V3 Raptor wasn't unfinished. That's actually what it will look like. He also stated that SpaceX aimed to eliminate as many bolted and welded joints as possible, which raised the engine's structural integrity.
But next gen, a bunch of the flanges you see here will disappear, and it will have integral cooling and integral secondary flow circuit.
But this does come with a downside. Maintenance on a V3 engine will be extremely difficult, requiring teams to cut into the engine for repairs. Musk simply said that that's what they'll do. The other exciting update Musk gave us was regarding the Star Factory. During the interview, he stated that the Star Factory should be fully equipped in just 3 months. This interview was recorded about 2 weeks ago, so we should start seeing the Star Factory ramp up production by September. Speaking of production, Musk stated that this Star Factory should be able to produce up to 100 starships per year, one ship every 3 days. What? But this isn't enough to reach his goal of 1,000 starships a year. This would need several Star Factories. Hopefully, we will get one over here in Florida soon. A huge thanks goes to Tim Dodd for bringing all this exciting information to us. I hope it helps compensate for the Dear Moon disappointment at least somewhat. Tim, you rock. Now let's talk Europe. It has a special place in my heart. After all, I am from Germany, so seeing spaceflight happen in Europe makes me feel all warm and fuzzy. To be honest though, for the past few years, there wasn't much fuzziness to be had. Since October of last year, Europe hasn't even had an operational rocket. This was due to a perfect storm of retiring old rockets, delays in new rockets, and failures of remaining rockets. This has led to the situation Europe is in now, with not a single operational orbital class rocket. But that may be about to change, because on June 21st, after a short delay, Europe's new rocket, the Ariane 6, performed its last major test before its maiden launch. That test was the wet dress rehearsal, in which the rocket was fully fueled and a simulated countdown ran until just before T-0. Everything seems to have gone well, and ESA's director Josef Aschbacher confirmed that the launch is now scheduled for July 9th. Yes! This date is almost exactly 4 years after the original planned launch date, which was initially supposed to be in July of 2020. So hopefully Arianespace and the European Space Agency have taken the extra time to work out any kinks in the design, and this maiden flight will go off spectacularly well. I know, I'll be watching. That's it for today. Remember to smash the like button. Subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and it helps us immensely. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode. If a tile... If a... Please... into looking looky looky
reusable
we will get on this crap chi whoopee whoopee how the how the how the how